Next, we will hear from our National Director of Church Planting, Tom Ricks. And that's a subject really close to my heart. Tom.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your gospel that goes into every corner of the world. And Lord, we pray that you would use us to share that gospel. In particular, Lord, in these few moments, we pray for church planting in the EPC, that we would trust you and we would follow you, and that you would grow the opportunities that we have to share Jesus with others through church planting. We pray in our Lord's name. Amen. Our report today consists of three things. The first thing we're going to do is watch a video that's just a brief update. Secondly, Ben Cunningham, who has been an EPC church planter for the last several years, is going to give a brief report. And then we're going to pray for our active church planters who are in the room. So watch the screen. We'll start with the video.
Hey, folks. Tom Ricks here, National Director of Church Planting for the EPC. And in the next few minutes, we're going to share with you a lot of the different voices that are actively planting churches in the EPC. You're going to hear from folks from coast to coast. You're going to hear from church planters. You're going to hear from some of our national leadership church planting team members. You're going to hear from our state clerk, Dean Weaver. And all of this is intended to help our denomination as a whole understand our church planting, how it fits into who we are and our DNA. And so kind of sit back, enjoy, and hopefully you'll learn a little something about EPC church planting.
So if I were gonna create like a Great Commission sermon, church planting might be my first point. In today's society, probably the best way that we can reach people who don't know the Lord is through church planting.
It was easy to say yes to being a church planter in the Pacific Northwest because there's a lot of people with a spiritual hunger. We started our church plant 4 years ago, which means that we hit COVID. And what you would have thought would have been a low really became a high because we refocused our church planting energy from being a Sunday-centric church plant to being a neighborhood-centric church plant, and that has brought us a lot of life.
We're in the southern part of Kansas City, but we look across the city and we're convinced that it's imperative that the gospel get out to the different areas of the region. And so our passion has been to look for ways that we can mobilize the gifts and the abilities that we have at our church and then spill those out into the community through church planting.
When you have a building and established ways, you can forget that Christians are not just people who worship and serve here and there. They're people on mission. And when you're schlepping boxes every Sunday morning, there's no way to forget that.
I'm looking for the next church for my children. And I believe that as we continue to build leaders and churches, we're reaching generations longer than we're alive.
It has been a joy to go and try to find some of those people who are ruling elders or adult leaders who have some energy and have some wisdom and maturity and want to offer it in new ways. And I've had the joy of seeing men and women in our presbytery get energized by the thought that God might plant a church in a community that might be the kind of thing that family member who's far from the Lord might try, as opposed to like the established small church in their hometown.
Spokane has about 529,000 people, and in the religious database it'll say, Baptist 12,000, and RCA 15,000, whatever it says. And when I got to the end, it said something like 350,000 unclaimed. While I'm still breathing, how could I not plant a church? How could I not try to claim those people?
The number of families that we have around us is far more than we anticipated. And the number of families who are looking for community and also a place to raise their kids in some kind of moral environment is also far more than we anticipated. So we're trying to learn, how do we grow as a church that ministers not only to adults who need to know Jesus, but also how do we make disciples who faithfully follow Jesus in every generation?
Increasingly, we have an entire series of generations that didn't grow up in church. They don't have the terminology, they don't have the culture, the ethos, any of that. So we're really talking about doing evangelism with those in our own communities who don't know the Lord and have never grown up in the church. And there's no better instrument than a brand new church plant to be able to do that.
Whether you're a pastor of a large church, an influential church, or whether you're a pastor of a small church or a church planter like mine, the EPC wants to emphasize that church planting is one of its gospel priorities. It's the EPC putting its money where its mouth is in many ways. That's exciting to me.
Well, good afternoon. My name is Ben Cunningham, and I'm the pastor of Church of the Resurrection in New Orleans. And Tom asked me to just share very briefly the story of our church plant, but to do so speaking specifically to the value of our supporting churches, our parent, partner, and patron churches. The value is inestimable, but I got just a few minutes, and I want to share a few things that I hope encourage all of us to get involved. Number one, to support church planting ultimately is not really just to support church planting, it is to do the work together as one. In other words, it is to embody the work of the Spirit together. One of the great challenges of church planting is fighting the temptation of thinking that you are charged with the task of creation ex nihilo, that you have to create everything from nothing all alone. And that is not true. In the beginning, when our congregation was formless and void and darkness was over the face of the deep, here's what we found. The will of the Father was already set, and the presence of Jesus was already in front of us, and the Spirit of God was already preparing and envisioning the creation of our congregation. But here's the point. We found out about God's provision for us through the provision of our supporting churches. Their provision was God's provision. God worked on our behalf through them. So there was really no separation. So in the earliest of days, when we had just 12 folding chairs in a circle, it was my great joy to sit down and say, hey, these aren't just the musings of a single church planter in a coffee shop. This is not me shooting from the hip. We belong to the great cloud of witnesses. And that is expressed locally and specifically through the body of Christ in our region. Here are five churches across the Gulf South, led by First Pres in Baton Rouge, who have been praying for us and preparing for us, shaping this congregation in response to the call of God. And as it went forward in the earliest of years, for the first 5 years, as we started to expand our staff and expand our outreach and evangelism and our ministries, even after getting localized and now looking for a permanent church building, those relationships were just forged there more strongly than ever. Now they are what we lean on still for wisdom, for encouragement, for provision. God's provision is their provision. And here's the thing, here's where we're at today. It's really indiscernible as to whom all the joy of it belongs. Does it belong to our church or does it belong to them? The answer is yes. So in supporting church planting, it's not just a contribution for someone else to do all the work. We embody the work of the Spirit together. The conversions are yours to celebrate. The discipleship is yours to celebrate. The fruit is your fruit. The advancement of the truth and grace of Jesus Christ and the peace and justice of his kingdom is yours to celebrate. We do it together. Here's the last thing. One more word of encouragement. I believe that church planting, as the video just said, is one of the great ways that we as a denomination can make the most of what God has blessed us with. I love the EPC. I love being in this denomination. And it's no secret that the EPC right now is enjoying a truly unique season of peace, in that we are not primarily preoccupied with infighting and controversy. Praise God. Amen? Amen. Praise God. So what should we do with that? What are those gifts for? Are they for ourselves, or are they the best opportunity to turn them outwards that all may come to know the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ? Are they for the sake of heaven on earth? If so, then let's church plant. Amen? Thank you.
Mr. Moderator, we'd like to conclude our report with a time of prayer for church planters, which includes you. So if you're a church planter currently in the room, which would be a miracle, because we tend to hang out in the hallways in there, stand up, please, where you are. And if you see a church planter standing anywhere around you, we've got one back there. They're all in the back, one back, Matt back there. Get around them and lay hands on them. So you got to move a little bit, and you got to move quickly because I'm on the clock. And we have two up here, Ben. So, gentlemen, I need y'all to lay hands on them while we pray. If you would, if you're about, yeah, come on, Brad. I'll give you about 10 more seconds to get around somebody, and then I'm going to lead us in prayer. All righty, let's pray. And as I pray, you pray for them as well. Father, the blessing of the gospel, we've only touched the outer edges of it. We won't know it in its fullness until we see you and see our risen Lord Jesus. But we have that sure and certain hope, and we want to share that with others. Father, thank you for all of the gospel initiatives, for global outreach, for church health, for church leadership. Thank you for the opportunity to plant churches. Lord, I pray for these church planters specifically this afternoon. They have wonderful opportunities in front of them, but they are challenging. They are no harder than other church pastor responsibilities. They're unique, but there are challenges. There are obstacles. Our enemy would want to destroy our church planting movement in the EPC. And so we pray for these men and women right now, Lord, that you would strengthen them, that you would equip them for the calling that you have laid upon their lives. Lord, that you would surround them with godly people who pray for them, who love them well, even sometimes asking them the tough questions. Father, I pray that you would guard their hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, to the extent that your kingdom would grow in our own hearts and the hearts and the minds of our church planters, but also that your kingdom would grow through people hearing the gospel, seeing it lived out in front of them, and being used by EPC church planters to be drawn by you into your kingdom. So, Father, we give them to you. We ask your blessing upon them, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Try to remember the name of the church planter you just laid hands on and pray for that person for the next 12 months until you lay hands on somebody else, Lord willing, next year at GA. And Mr. Moderator, this concludes my report.